Welcome back from break. Let me see. Yeah, the transcription is here. Awesome. So, continuing on. Victoria, did you have a question or can I mute you?
Oh, mute.
Oh, no problem. So, continuing on with our discussion on conversion factors, one of the things that I also like to discuss in this class as an application of a conversion factor is clinical problems. This pertains a lot to students that are going into nursing. So put a one in the chat if you are a student that wants to transfer into a nursing program. Excellent. So when it comes to going to nursing school, it can be because you want to do an RN program, a nurse practitioner program, or you want to do your BSN. One of the courses that you actually take is learning how to dose patients. Now, understand that when it comes to this, I want to illustrate just, at least to give you guys examples on how we do these calculations. Understand that this is just how I teach them, so at least you guys have some experience with them. But of course, as you move on in your programs, you will have the opportunity to actually do more problems like this. Now, in this course, when it comes to clinical problems, I introduce to you guys on how to do them. And specifically in these problems, only in clinical problems, I tell you how many significant figures I want to see in the final answer. So let's deal with the first problem that we have here. In this clinical problem, it reads, a doctor's orders prescribed a dosage of 0.150 milligrams of Synthroid. Synthroid is going to be the medication. If tablets in stock contain 75 micrograms of Synthroid, how many tablets are required to provide the prescribed medication? So in this problem, you have two pieces of information, which is what's going to be the doctor's orders. So let's just write that. So we have the doctor's orders, which is 0.150 milligrams. And then we have what we call a clinical factor, which is what is the medicine that you have in hand? Understand that this can be milligrams per tablet, milligrams per capsules. Sometimes we have milligrams per milliliters, so on and so forth, just to give you guys an example. So that's what we call the clinical factor. In this problem, our clinical factor establishes that we have specifically 75 micrograms of the medication. Now, when you're dealing with these problems, the first thing that you have to pay attention is that this unit and this unit match. If they do not match, please don't plug in any numbers in the calculator until you do the conversion so they match. Believe it or not, it is a problem still to date, overdosing or underdosing patients as hospitals. So understand that, it is important that at times you know how to do this by hand, okay? In certain countries, so for example, in Puerto Rico, I have certain family members that are nurses. And even though, yes, in the hospital, there are the technology that will tell you, oh, this is what you need to do in order to give this dosage to the patient. At least I have a cousin that told me that the head nurse in her division makes them write in so they understand what they're actually administering to people. And at least in my country, this is important because, for example, right now, June started. So from June to October, we have hurricane season. And in hurricane season, you may not have technology because, for example, there's, you know, if a hurricane comes, you may not have internet, you may not have electricity, you know, it does happen, especially in cases of emergency. So I know for a fact that for her, her head nurse makes sure that they not only use the technology available, but they also know how to do it in writing. So when it comes to this, the first thing that we need to make sure that we match is, let's make sure that those units match, okay? So at first, the first part of this problem, since they don't match, is that we are going to make sure that that 0.150 milligrams is converted into micrograms, okay? So if we go back and utilize our number line method, okay? In the number line method, we know that if we start at milli and we are going to micro, we are going to move that decimal place 1, 2, 3 times from left to right. So I know that I'm going to move this 1, 2, 3 times from left to right. So that means that the equality between milligrams and micrograms is that there's 150 micrograms in 0.150 milligrams. So now that we have these units the same, see, micrograms, and now we have our doctor's orders in micrograms, then we can proceed to the next step, which is to know how many tablets to provide to this patient. So we're going to set up the problem. First, we're going to write our doctor's orders, which is 150 micrograms. Then we are going to write in as a fraction our clinical factor. Okay. So our clinical factor is that for every 75 micrograms of med, that corresponds to 1 tablet. Okay. So because I'm trying to cancel the micrograms, I'm going to write here 75 micrograms because I want those units to cancel. And then on top, I'm going to put what that is equal to, 1 tablet. So to finalize the problem, utilizing dimensional analysis, I'm going to do 150 times 1, and all of that is divided by 75. So when we do this, this patient needs 2 tablets. Let's practice a problem. So I'm going to give you guys 2 minutes to do the following problem. A patient is prescribed 1.25 grams of amoxicillin, which is available in 250 milligram tablets. How many tablets are needed? Again, we are going to express our answer in 1 significant figure. So I'm going to give you guys 2 minutes to complete this problem. Okay, let's get started. So in this problem, our doctor's orders or the prescription that needs to be given to the patient. Is 1.25 grams of amoxicillin. Amoxicillin is an antibiotic. Then our clinical factor is that we have 250 milligrams of this medication per one tablet. Okay, so taking this into consideration, you can see that your clinical factor and your prescription don't have the same unit because here we have grams and here we have milligrams, okay? So the first step is to make sure that the prescription that needs to be given or the doctor's orders for that matter need to match. So we need to do as step number one, take that 1.25 grams and change it to milligrams. Okay. So how many milligrams are in 1.25 grams? Great job. There is 1,250 milligrams, okay? Remember, in this problem for clinical problems, we only need to worry about that. At the end, we only have one sig fig. So please don't be discouraged by saying like, oh my God, where are the sig figs? Calm down. In these problems, only in clinical factors, we have to just, you know, worry about everything that we have at the end. So now that we have our prescription or the doctor's orders at the right unit, we're going to write it down. So 1,250 milligrams. Now we are going to use our clinical factor. We know that we have 250 milligrams of the medication in one tablet. So when I'm trying to determine my final answer, I'm going to do 1,250 times 1, and I'm going to divide that value by 250. The milligram units cancel each other, so I know that my answer is going to be in tablets. So how many tablets does this patient get? Excellent, 5 tablets. Any questions when you have a clinical problem in which you have two pieces of information, the prescription that needs to be given or the doctor's orders and a clinical factor? Any questions? Then let's go to the other type of clinical problem that you guys need to be familiar with, which is you have a doctor's orders, you have your clinical factor, but you now have to take into account what is the weight of your patient, okay? That's this type of clinical problem. Let's go through the following example. You need to give the following medication, which is called Fortas, at 50 milligrams per kilogram to a child that specifically weighs 56 pounds. Fortas is going to be available as an oral suspension. Oral suspension means that it's in liquid form, but that oral suspension contains 100 milligrams of Fortas per milliliter. You need to know how many milliliters do you need to administer for the dose that is given. And in this problem, I want you guys to show it in two significant figures, okay? So again, let's write down the information that is given to us, which is the prescription which is 50. Milligrams per kilogram of weight of your patient. We have the weight of the patient, which is 56 pounds. Then we have our clinical factor. Remember that the clinical factor is always the same. The clinical factor is what medication do you have in hand? This specific medication is in liquid form. So it's going to have 100 milligrams of the med per 1 milliliter of the med. Okay, so those are my three pieces of information. So if you have a clinical problem of this fashion, then the first thing that you need to do is write in what is the weight of your patient. So we're going to write in 56 pounds. Because the prescription is in kilograms per milligrams of my medication, I need to make sure that that weight of the patient is in kilograms. So I'm going to utilize the conversion of 2.20 pounds in 1 kilogram to make sure that the weight of my patient is in the correct unit. That's the first thing we do. Equality to convert weight from pounds to kilograms. In the next step, I'm going to use my doctor's orders or the prescription that I need to give, okay? So that means that here, because I'm trying to cancel the units of kilograms, I'm going to say per kilogram, I need to give this patient 50 milligrams of the medication. In the last portion here, I need to utilize my clinical factor. Which tells me that every 100 milligrams of my medication is found in 1 milliliter. As you can see here, the pounds cancel with the pounds, the kilograms cancel with the kilograms, the milligrams cancel with the milligrams. So when I do all of this, okay, and let me just move it up here. In this dimensional analysis, I'm going to take 56, multiply it times 1, multiply it times 50, multiply it times 1, and all of that operation I'm going to do first. And then I'm going to do in a separate operation 2.20 times 100. That's how it needs to be entered in your calculator. Make sure that you guys know how to enter it in your calculator. Especially if you're using a graphing calculator, make sure that the bottom part of this, and sorry, there is a delay in the markings. There you go, it's all there. That 2.20 times 100, make sure that you put it in parentheses, because if not, it's going to give you a number that is not correct. So we do 56 times 1 times 50 times 1, and we divide it by 2.20 times 100. Give me one moment. Excellent. When we round it to the correct number of SIGFIDs, thank you, Dania. In GIA 2, I get that number also. This is 13 milliliters. Okay. Great. You guys got the same number I got. Let's do one practice problem. So again, I'm going to give you guys 2 minutes. I'm going to read the problem first. The doctor orders Lanoxin at 20.0 micrograms per kilogram. The stock supply of Lanoxin is 0.125 milligrams per milliliter. Your patient weighs 150 pounds. How many milliliters would you administer for the correct dose? So I'm going to give you guys 2 minutes to do the following problem. Excellent. Let's get started with this problem. So let's write in the information that is given to us. We have the doctor's orders, which is 20.0 micrograms per kilogram. We have the weight of the patient. We which is 150 pounds. Then we have our clinical factor. Which is 0.125 milligrams per 1 milliliter. Okay. So based on the example that we did before, what is the first step that we do? What is the first thing we do? Excellent. Change that weight. So we're going to write down the weight that we have, which is 150 pounds. And then remember, the conversion is 2.20 pounds in 1 kilogram. Now, before I add all the other things, there's one thing that we need to take into account when it comes to the clinical factor and the doctor's orders. And this problem we didn't have in the previous problem. Now, if we pay close attention to the doctor's orders versus the clinical factor, we may notice that our clinical factor and our doctor's orders do not match in unit. Great job, Jessica, exactly. So now we have to think about, oh, wait, I need to change my doctor's orders to match what my clinical factor is. Because in this case, if I just put in the numbers, I could overdose or I could underdose the patient, okay? So you cannot just take the 20 and carry on. We have to pay attention to the units. If we look at the example that we had before, we didn't have that problem. Look, my clinical factor is in milligrams. My prescription is a milligram, so I'm good. But here we have that issue. So that means that I have to make sure that this 20.0 micrograms I change to milligrams. Okay. So 20.0 micrograms, what is that equivalent to milligrams? So if I change that, excellent. So if I go from microgram to milligram, this is going to be, I didn't leave enough space, 0.0200 milligrams. Okay. And you guys, the reason why I put the zero before the decimal place is just because I'm accustomed to that in the training, the chemistry classes that I took since undergrad. So understand that when you guys are entering values into Canvas, I give you guys a format. So it can make a difference if you have that zero in the beginning or not. So make sure that you read the instructions, okay? So now I know that my doctor's orders is actually 0.0200 milligrams per kilogram. Now I can proceed, okay? So as we saw in the previous example, the next thing that I use is my doctor's orders. So I say per kilogram, I know that this patient needs to get 0.0200 milligrams of this medication. Then I use my clinical factor, which tells me that in this medication, I have 0.125 milligrams, okay, per milliliter. Okay, so to get my final answer, pounds counts with pounds, or cancels, sorry. Kilogram cancels with kilogram, milligrams cancels with milligrams. So my final answer is going to be in milliliters. So if I look at my mathematical operation, it needs to be entered in the calculator as 150 times 1 times 0.0200 times 1. The result of that needs to be divided. Give me one moment. This disconnected. So all of that needs to be divided by the result of the multiplication of 2.20 times 0.125. So it's 150 times 1 times 0.02 times 1 divided by 2.20 times 0.125. What did you guys get? If I put this in three sig figs. Excellent, that's what I got also. Now, I want you guys to understand something because I'm seeing some answers here and I don't want you guys to get it incorrect in the exam. My calculator display shows me 10.90909091. So when I round that calculator display to three sig figs, that is 10.9. 11.0 is not the answer. 11.0 does have three sig figs, but then you're rounding a number incorrectly. So make sure that when you're rounding, you round your calculator display to the number that is given in the problem. Any questions on doing clinical problems in which we have a doctor's orders, the weight of the patient, and a clinical factor? Excellent. Make sure that you practice. There are more problems like this in the in-class worksheet, and there's also some problems in the textbook that I suggested. So let's move on to the last concept that we need to deal with in chapter two, which is density. So density is actually a physical property of substances, and we're going to learn about physical properties in the upcoming chapter. But just to introduce density to you guys, this specific value is going to compare the mass of an object to its volume. So when it comes to density, understand that density is given by the equation that you see here. This equation establishes that density equals mass of the substance divided by the volume of the substance. And there's different things that density can allow us to understand in terms of how substances behave around each other. So first, I want to focus on the beaker that we have in the image on the right side of the slide. We can see here that this beaker contains five substances: a cork, a piece of ice, water, aluminum, and lead. So assuming that none of these substances interact with one another, we are looking at the properties of these substances when they are around each other. You can see that the substance that we have in greater amount is going to be water in liquid form. And the density of water is 1.00 grams per milliliter. Now, the two objects that we see, or the two substances that we see that have densities less than water, in this case, are floating. So you can see that the piece of cork is floating and the ice is also floating. And again, it's because they are less dense than water. On the other hand, we see that the piece of aluminum and the piece of lead have densities higher than the water. So we can observe in this image that if you have a substance that is more dense, it tends to be in the bottom. So in this case, because we're comparing everything to water, they're going to sink, okay? So that's one of the ways in which we can see how density plays a role on how certain substances are behaving around each other. Now, another way that we can see how density plays a role on objects of substances that are interacting with one another, put a one in the chat if you have ever seen these. I'm a mom, so I need to say if you are of the legal drinking age, but maybe you have gone out and you have seen people that have drinks that have different layers. They actually really, they look really cool. Like you see them that it looked like a rainbow, or is like, it could be just drinks that, put a one in the chat if you have seen that, that you see it, or even actually, my favorite is when I go and get aguas frescas, and depending on how sugary they are, then you can actually see the different layers. Like I usually get like dragon fruit with pineapple, and then you can see the dragon fruit and the pineapple separated. So it looks cool before they unify. Excellent. So a lot of people, I have some students that have seen that. Now, when it comes to density, and the reason why you are able to see those layered drinks is because you are taking into account, similar to what we saw before, the density of the objects, okay? So things that are more dense are going to tend to be in the bottom of your container. And things that are less dense tend to be higher in terms of how they accommodate in the container. So let's say that we're trying to stack different substances in the graduated cylinder that we have here. And let's say, I'm just going to take some of the substances that we have here, which we have their densities in grams per milliliter. Let's say that I select things that are not going to interact with each other. Let's say the Dawn soap. Let's select honey. Let's select baby oil. And let's do rubbing alcohol, why not? Again, let's assume that they don't interact with one another, okay? But these are the four things that I'm trying to see how they are going to stack in a graduated cylinder, which is my container. What substance, and let's put it in the chat, we're going to find in the bottom of this graduated cylinder, depending on the value of density that we see here. Great job. So honey, we can find in the bottom because it has a density that is higher compared to the other ones. What's going to be on top of the honey? I agree with you guys. Yes, the soap, because that is going to be less dense than the honey. What substance is going to stack on top of the soap? Great. The alcohol. And then lastly, we can envision that our baby oil will be stacked. And again, it's all based on the differences in densities that we have for each of them. So let me just write the values. This is because it's 1.36. This one has 1.03, 0.87, 0.82. Now, I am assuming that all of these substances are not interacting with one another, and that's why we're able to do this. If these substances can mix, then of course, then this is not going to look like this. But again, I'm just illustrating an application of density. So when it comes to what you guys need to know in terms of density, in addition of knowing how materials are going to interact with one another in terms of their density, because we are introducing a lot of math problems, of course we have to do math, okay? And to practice math problems in density, we have the following problems. We can see here that we have to utilize the different equations. So let me at least introduce the equations that you need to know. So what is the equation of density? D equals M over V. So because we have three terms in this density equation, we can actually isolate just the mass. And the mass of an object can be given by taking the density and multiplying it times the volume. Then understand that volume is a term that we can have by itself. And volume is going to equal the mass of the object divided by the density. Again, for exam one, you guys need to know how to utilize each of these equations, okay? So let's go through the first problem. It says, a piece of tin has a mass of 16.52 grams and a volume of 2.26 centimeters cubed. So understand that volume, especially if it's a solid, it can be given by centimeters cubed. It could be in milliliters. So understand that volume can be given in different units. So if I say that this is equation one, this is equation two, and this is equation three, then looking at these, which equation am I using? One, two, or three? Let's put it in the chat. Great job. We need equation one because we're looking for the density. Look at what the question is asking. What is density of tin? So here, understand that this known and unknown basically is the known information versus the unknown information. So the known is going to be mass and volume, but the unknown is density. So that's what we're solving for. So D equals M over V. My mass is 16.52 grams. My volume is 2.26 centimeters cubed. So that means that this density is going to be given in units of grams per centimeters cubed. Now, I know that we can put those numbers in the calculator, 16.52 divided by 2.26, and I got a calculator display of 7.309734, yada, yada, yada. Now, how many stick figs do I need to show? Great job, three stick figs. So when I take that value and I round it to the correct number of stick figs, it's going to be 7.31, okay? Let's go through another problem that we have from the in-class worksheet. So you can see that it says, what is the volume? But notice that at this point, we want a volume in a particular unit. We want our volume in liters, okay? So we have to keep track of that. And we have a piece of metal that is 325 grams, and we have a density of 9.0 grams per centimeters cubed. So because we're finding volume, which equation do I need? One, two, or three? Great job. We need the third equation. So I'm trying to find volume. So volume equals M over D. Remember, the known here is the mass and the density. The unknown here is going to be the volume in liters. Okay. So at first, I'm going to plug in the numbers that I have for the mass. 325 grams. The density is 9.0 grams per centimeters cubed. So that means that my unit out of this is centimeters cubed. Okay? So in terms of centimeters cubed, when I do that division, 325 divided by 9.0, okay? I find that is going to be 36.111, and let me just do the, because that's my calculator display, okay? So I'm not done yet because I need my volume in liters. Now, if I go to my equations from table 2.7, okay, I can see that centimeters cubed is the same thing as milliliters, okay? So centimeters cubed is the same thing as milliliters. So in this problem, this is the same thing of saying, this is 36.111, and I'm gonna do the three dots just to not write the whole calculator display, milliliters. So overall, I need to convert that number from milliliters to liters, okay? So the in 1 liter, there's 1,000 milliliters. And I have to make sure that I show two sig figs, because remember, this is two sig figs, this is three sig figs. So because that's the fewest sig figs and I'm multiplying and dividing, that's why I need to show this number as two sig figs. So when I change from milliliters to liters, I have to move that decimal place three times from right to left. So my final answer is 0.036 liters. Any questions on density problems? Great. Since there are no questions, this concludes all the topics from chapter two. And now, let me move on to the beginning. We are moving on to chapter three. So in chapter three is where we deal with the concepts of matter, and we learn how to define matter. We already heard the definition of matter yesterday. And now we're going to see how we can classify it, the different properties that it has, some of the changes that it actually undergoes, and then we are going to learn about energy. So, as a review, the first thing that we learned in class yesterday was the concept of chemistry is going to study the composition, the properties, the changes of matter. And we also learned that matter is anything that has mass and occupies space. So even though we are surrounded by many things that are matter, understand that matter is not everything that we have around us, okay? The majority of things, yes, but there's things that we experience in this life that by definition in chemistry, they are not considered matter, okay? So let's talk first of things that are defined as matter in chemistry. So as you can see, we can have a piece of wood, a stone, water, a bucket, a cylinder, fire, all of those things. Again, because they have mass and occupy space, we define it as matter. Now, there are things that we can see and they are in this world that are not defined as matter. Again, it's because they don't fit the definition of has mass and occupy space. So a rainbow is not considered matter. Light is not considered matter. Heat is not considered matter. A reflection, a memory. Understand love. All of those things are not considered as matter because they don't have mass or occupy space. And in order for something to be considered matter, it needs to fit into those two parameters. Now, out of the things that are considered matter, we can further classify them into two types of matter. First, pure substances, and others are considered mixtures, okay? So, anything that's matter, we can, as you can see in the flow chart, we can move it onto the left side of the flow chart. We can have pure substances. And if something is not considered a pure substance, it's considered a mixture. And in this week's lab, you guys are actually dealing with mixtures and you're trying to separate the components of them. But let's define them one at a time. So the type of matter that is considered a pure substance, there are two examples of it. So pure substances are either considered pure elements or pure compounds. And pure elements are going to be the elements of the periodic table. You can see that element is just defined as a substance that is composed of one type of atom. So any of the elements in the periodic table are considered pure elements, and they are pure substances. Now, in those pure substances, we can also have compounds. And what is a compound is going to be a substance that is composed of two or more elements that are always combined in the same proportion. So what does that mean? That, for example, if we look at the chemical formula of water, water is H2O. H2O is always composed of two hydrogens and one oxygen. And those elements are chemically linked to one another. Now, the other type of matter that we can have is going to be a mixture, okay? And mixtures can be either homogeneous mixtures or they can be heterogeneous mixtures. And what is the difference between them? Well, remember that a mixture is going to be a substance that is made up of two or more chemical substances. But the key to remember what makes a mixture is that those components in the mixture are not chemically bonded to one another. Now, you may ask yourself, okay, what is the difference between having a homogeneous mixture and a heterogeneous mixture? Well, the homogeneous mixture has a uniform composition throughout. So that means that you cannot see the different components that is in there. So for example, here we have salt water, mouthwash, and even alloys. Alloys, let me define it for those of you that don't know what alloys are. Alloys are a combination of different metal elements. Now, let me establish that alloys, those elements are not chemically linked to one another. They're just physically combined. So substances like steel, bronze, they are examples of alloy, okay? Now, we can also have a heterogeneous mixture. And in a heterogeneous mixture, as you can see, the composition varies from one part of the mixture to the other. And in heterogeneous mixtures, for the most part, you can see all of the components of the mixtures. So again, the take-home message from here is that when we have matter, we can classify it as pure substances or mixtures, okay? And then from the pure substance family, we have elements, and we can find them in the periodic table, or we can have compounds, which are elements that are chemically linked to one another to make those compounds. Mixtures, on the other hand, which is the other type of matter, we can have homogeneous mixtures or heterogeneous mixtures. And remember that a mixture is going to have two or more different chemical substances that are not chemically bonded to one another. Now, as you can see here, when we have a mixture, you can utilize separation methods to discover the different pure substances that are going to be present in that mixture, or in the case of the lab that you guys are doing this week, is going to be the different components of the mixture. So let me just make a note here. In lab one, and now that OLabs is working, understand that you will be able to do the whole lab. So in lab one, let's say that you guys are separating camphor, which for the purposes of this lab, camphor is just another name that is utilized for the compound ammonium chloride. You are separating it from sand, and you are separating that from salt, which is one of the ways. Understand that sand is a mixture, and we are not separating sand further, okay? So in this week's lab, what you guys are doing virtually is separating two pure substances. Let me just use my highlighter tool. So in this week's lab, you guys have two pure substances, and you are separating it from a mixture, okay? Because we are not separating sand further. But you can see that through physical methods, you can, or separation methods, you can actually isolate pure substances from a mixture, okay? Now, some of these separation techniques, okay, can include the use of a funnel. They can include the use of a magnet. They can include the use of heat, so you can boil certain substances. Now, if for those of you that have seen the pre-lab video, you have explored how in this lab, we are utilizing the separation methods of introducing heat. So in the first step during sublimation, we are using heat in order to transition that ammonium chloride into gas form so it then solidifies. We're going to talk about sublimation in a most likely at the end of class. No, we're going to talk about it tomorrow. But when it comes to sublimation, it's just a way in which we can separate one of the components of the mixture using heat, and then the separation of the sand and salt, you guys are utilizing a funnel, okay? So as you can see illustrated here, the funnel is utilized to separate liquids from solids. And the boiling, at times it can utilize to separate solids from liquids, or in this case, a solid that can be transformed into gas form. The magnet is usually utilized in the cases that one of the components have magnetic properties, so it will be attracted to a magnet in order to isolate itself from the components of the mixture. So understand that there's different ways, and you guys in lab will be exploring different methods. Now, in order for us to solidify what is a pure substance and what is a mixture, we are going to go through part A of the in-class worksheet, in which we have a list of components, and then we're going to determine if they are pure substances or mixtures. So in the chat, let's put PS for pure substance, and let's put an M for mixtures, okay? And when it comes to this, you guys, please do not overthink it. Don't be like, what if it's this type of water? If it's carbonated water, or I only drink alkaline water. I just mean water. So please don't be overthinking these. Take it as it was given to you, okay? So let's go through these. Number one, sodium. What kind of matter it is? Great, this is a pure substance. What is the symbol for sodium? Excellent, Na. Then we have water. What is water? Pure substance or a mixture? Ooh, I see some M's. My friends, water is just a pure substance. This is just H2O. If we're talking salt water, that's a mixture. Sugar water, that's a mixture. But water by itself, that is just a compound made out of two hydrogens and one oxygen. Soil. Great job, that's a mixture. Coffee. Great. Now, one of the things that I'm not trying to be tricky. So if you come to class, you watch the videos, you know what I'm talking about. What if I use the word organic coffee? What is organic coffee? Great job. Organic coffee is still a mixture. The word organic doesn't make things pure, okay? Unless something is pure before the word organic, then when you add the word organic, it remains to be pure. That also means that if you have something that it is a mixture before you add the word organic, understand that it remains a mixture after using the word organic. So I know that you guys are not gonna mess that in the exam. Please remember, if something adding the word organic does not change it all of a sudden into a pure substance. In common language, organic, when you buy something organic at the store, just means that it was grown without pesticides. That's all it means. In chemistry terms, it means something else. Okay. Number five, oxygen. What's oxygen? Excellent. That is a pure substance. What is the symbol for oxygen? Great, capital O. Isopropyl alcohol. I'm not talking the one that you have at home. Great, that is a pure substance. Isopropyl alcohol has three hydrogens. Nine hydrogens and an oxygen. Let me just draw it. Oh no, my hydrogens are off. Okay. So it's going to show up in it has three carbons, eight hydrogens, and one oxygen. You will see the markings. So isopropyl alcohol has 3 carbons, 8 hydrogens, and 1 oxygen. Give me one moment, because it disconnected. I'm here. Can you guys hear me now? Put a 1 in the chat. Awesome. It's just the internet connection. Sometimes it does this. Great. So when it comes to isopropyl alcohol, not the one that you may have at home, but pure isopropyl alcohol is a pure substance, because it has 3 carbons, 8 hydrogens, and 1 oxygen, okay? Now, if there is a compound that I know you guys are not familiar with, I tend to put in parentheses or in a comma the chemical formula, and that should give you a hint that, oh, that's a pure substance. Sorry, you guys, that this kicked me out, but I will be illustrating the slides in a moment. Let me reconnect it. Excellent. Put a 1 in the chat if you can hear me now. Put a 1 in the chat if you guys can hear me now. Great, there's a little bit of a delay. So again, the isopropyl alcohol that you have at home, if it says 90%, 70%, then that is a mixture, because the other amount to make it to 100 is water. But if we're talking about isopropyl alcohol by itself, then that is a pure substance because it is a compound. As I said, if there is a chemical that I know that maybe you're not familiar with, sorry, this is going to come in and out, then I tend to put the chemical formula either in parentheses or in a comma, and that should give you guys a hint that we're talking about a pure substance. Let me just connect and then finish up these so we can wrap up today's lecture. The difference between a solution and a pure substance is that a pure substance is a solution is another word for homogeneous mixture. So number 7, pure substance or mixture. Great, this is a pure substance. Carbon dioxide is CO2. Cake batter is a mixture, even if it's gluten-free, or even if it's, fat-free, a cake batter is still a mixture. Air. There you go. I saw some pure substance. Air is a mixture, you guys. Air, remember we did it in the trivia yesterday. Air is composed of nitrogen, oxygen. There's different things in it. Chicken noodle soup. Excellent. This is a mixture. Okay. So again, when it comes to these, remember, if there is a name in which I put the chemical formula, just like I did here on number 6, on number 2, on number 7, then understand that that should give you a hint that, oh, wait, she gave me a name. I'm not familiar with the name, but she gave me the chemical formula. So that implies that it is a pure substance. Okay. Oh, unless it is organic. That's a great one. Okay. So tomorrow we are going to continue talking about chapter 3. We're going to finish chapter 3 and move on to chapter 4. This is all what I have for you guys today. Thank you for coming. Have a great day.
Thank you.